Hello, I'm Kerry Haney, an associate professor of political science here at Duke University. Today we have a guest on campus, Mr. Michael Steele. Mr. Steele's here, invited by the Duke Sanford School of Public Policy, and I want to spend some time in conversation with you, Mr. Steele,
sure,
about a number of issues. This interview and this conversation is sponsored by Duke Sanford Institute's J. Rutherford Living History and the Heart Leadership Program.
Mm-hmm.
So welcome to Duke.
It's great to be at Duke, absolutely.
Great. I want to start out, here we are on October the 22nd, 2008, 2 weeks away from what might be an historic election if Senator Obama is elected President
right.
of the United States. If he were to win, what would it mean for politics in this country and for the society as a whole?
Well, I think it certainly would be transformative. There's no doubt about that. I think, you know, certainly the first African-American president would be something that a lot of people, regardless of ideology, political ideology, would gravitate towards. I think it certainly would mean a lot in terms of how America has moved itself along the course of racial history. But the one thing I spent a lot of time over the last year trying to dispel is this notion that all of a sudden we're going to be this, you know, this uber racial society, that people all of a sudden are going to start loving each other, and that redlining will not happen in black neighborhoods, and that, you know, the academic performance of African-American kids are going to shoot through the roof. And so I think there's a lot of anticipation, obviously, but also a lot of, I think, unintended consequences that can come. In other words, this is all brand new territory,
right,
and certain things will happen and fall into place that will, would, you know, whether were Barack white, people would look at and go, oh, okay, but being black, people pay more attention to.
Right.
And there are consequences that will fall from that. And I think it's going to be a very interesting and delicate time for the country, but very also very hopeful for what may come down the road.
Right. And then you have some experience with this. I mean, I should add for our viewers that you were elected, the first African-American elected.
First African-American statewide in Maryland when I was elected lieutenant governor in 2002.
And the first Republican to hold that
position. First Republican to ever hold the office. And in 2006, I ran for the United States Senate, hoping we would get the first black from Maryland to the U.S. Senate, which would have been only the seventh African-American, or seventh or eighth African-American in the U.S. Senate. So.
Right, right. So there was some particular expectations of you as an African-American lieutenant governor.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, in fact, there were expectations of me as an African-American running for the office of lieutenant governor and for the United States Senate that have not been placed on Obama running.
Like what?
Well, for example, I remember very vividly and I guess in some ways excitedly having to confront a lot of issues that in addition to what were more general issues for the broader population of Maryland. African Americans had a very high expectation that if I go to the Senate, if I got to the Senate, that I would carry that agenda with me and make, you know, the black agenda from Maryland, you know, whether it was educational, health care, recidivism rates among young people, incarceration rates, all of that, carry that with me to the Senate. That has not been a part of the public discourse or dialogue in this presidential race in terms of what is the black agenda if, upon the election of a black man to president, where's our seat at the table? I think it's a very profound question that the community has to answer for itself. Barack has not answered it. Folks would argue, well, because if he does, it turns off the white vote. I disagree with that because in Maryland, in answering that question, the white community embraced it because they figured, well, you're a black guy. Yeah, so we expect you to also have a sensitivity towards those issues that are unique to your community.
You're also a Republican, though.
And also a Republican, which really
right.
squirrels people's heads around sometimes.
Right.
But, you know, the reality for me is public service leadership boils down to some fundamental principles that that link you to the people that you work with and work for. And when you assume high office, whether it's lieutenant governor, senator, or president, those expectations are part of the package in terms of how you perform in your leadership.
Right, right. Let me ask this question. What if it turns out that Senator Obama loses in about 2 weeks?
Mm-hmm.
What would that mean for the country?
Well, you know, I think the historic nature of it doesn't change. He will have done and more than any other African American, and certainly more than anyone would expect from a two-term state senator from Illinois.
Right.
I think also, I know a lot of people, and I've already begun to hear it, and it really frightens me a little bit, are beginning to say that, well, America is turning back the clock and that it's not as progressive. Well, that's a bunch of you-know-what. It's not a statement at all. At some point, Americans will make a judgment and are making a judgment about whether or not philosophically, experientially, judgmentally, whatever their barometers are for selecting the next president, they're going to apply those standards, they're going to apply that barometer to these individuals. And if they marry up to them, great. If they don't, they won't vote for them.
Right.
And so if Barack loses in 2 weeks, then, you know, it's the judgment of the country will be, under these circumstances, in these times, this is the leader we wanted. And we move on from there.
Right.
Now, I know some will not go quietly into
right.
that good
right.
night. I don't think we can make a negative judgment of the American people unless there's evidence, clear and convincing evidence, that, we voted against him because he's black.
Right.
I would submit to you that there will be as many voting for him because he's black as are voting against him because he's black. And I'd be honest about it. When I ran for the United States Senate, I had to take into account that there was a certain percentage of people within my own party.
Right.
Within my own party who wouldn't vote for me because I'm black.
Right.
So you take that and extrapolate it across a population of people, voters, Democrat, Republican, Independent, and otherwise, yeah, there's going to be a certain percentage that won't for purely racial reasons. And there will be an equal or maybe greater percentage who will vote for you because it's historic and they want to be, quote, on the right side of history
right.
and all of that.
Right.
So there are dynamics at play here that are really uncharted for many Americans. Our feelings, our emotions are wrapped up in these dynamics.
Right.
We don't know how we'll respond if he wins, really, or how we'll respond if he loses.
Right.
We know that there will be a response, and that will be interesting to gauge when it happens.
Right. Now, you mentioned in your race, and when you became Lieutenant Governor, you won that election, there must have been some African-American Democrats who voted for you in that election.
There were, in fact. One of the biggest challenges, particularly in this era where the Republican brand, quite frankly, sucks. I mean, it's just a terrible brand.
Hmm.
It is not. It is. I've just been stunned at how a party can let its brand slip as quickly and as precipitously and as poorly as the GOP has. But that's the card you dealt with. And so the reality of it for me in running in 2002 and especially in 2006 was to carve out who I am, to define myself. And it was really kind of speaking to how my mama raised
right,
me too.
Right.
Because my mother raised me to be my own person, to be my own individual. And so, you know, I'm not defined by the GOP. My job is to define the GOP.
Right.
And so I spent the better part of my professional political career doing that. But in 2002, given that Maryland is out, you know, 2-1 Democrat, it is a decidedly blue state. It leans very liberal in its philosophical orientation. You had to find those issues where you sort of draw people to your perspective, an appreciation of that perspective, without getting lost in the weeds of party labels
right.
and brand. And I think we were successful in doing that. And in 2006, that was especially important because I wasn't running as part of a ticket. It was, you know, a solo act. You're just kind of flying out there. You're having an unpopular war, an unpopular president. The economy was still strong at that time. And so it was really the war which fixated the imaginations and the concerns of people. And you had to address that.
Right.
And where the party was, particularly the president, and where Maryland was, were in two polar positions. And so it was very, very tough waters to navigate. But in the course of navigating that, I was able to secure the endorsement of individuals like Russell Simmons, five sitting Democrat elected officials in my county, home
right.
county of Prince George's County. And so it really spoke to the ability to sort of draw people to that table. And their rationale for it was when Steele goes to the Senate, we know he'll take us with us, that his agenda will be our agenda. It will not be a party agenda. it will not necessarily be an agenda of George Bush and the Republican Party. And I think that was very important to make very clear, to delineate, not running away from Bush, but making very clear, I'm my own person.
Right, right. This is very interesting. I mean, particularly in light of this week, in the last few days, there have been some talk on talk radio, I think Rush Limbaugh in particular, who made a statement in response to General Powell's endorsement of Senator Obama, that it was 100% race, about race, I think is what his comment was. I mean, and what you just said is that it's not that.
That
you presented
a credible argument to people of an opposing political perspective, and they agreed with it.
Right.
And I think with General Powell, first off, for anybody who didn't think that General Powell was going to endorse Barack Obama, you have not been following this campaign at all.
Right.
You were totally clueless, number one. Number two, Powell telegraphed this endorsement for 8 months.
Right.
He's been quietly and sometimes not so quietly supporting him and providing him with counsel. All right? We figured that out. Right. Number three, General Powell, very much like many other African Americans, is his own man. And has lived through some of the more troubling times in American histories, and happens to be alive at a very significant and important time in America's history. So he's been able to juxtapose those two within the context of his own life, and have come to certain judgments about this time and the leadership that's required. Now, I disagree with that judgment. But I respect it and understand it and appreciate it and would not diminish it by saying it was 100% based on race. Yes, race was a portion of it. There's a certain racial pride that all of us have, that even I have, even though I don't support Barack for the office. I do have a great deal of racial pride. Just as Barack came to Maryland to campaign against me when I ran for the U.S. Senate, I'm sure if you asked him, he was proud that, the black guy's running, but philosophically, this guy's wrong for Maryland. Right. Well, philosophically, Barack is wrong for this office.
Right.
That's where we come down. And I think Colin Powell sort of went through that whole evolutionary process himself and concluded differently. So I wouldn't belittle it or recharacterize it as something that's solely based on race. Race was a part of it, but so was every other aspect of it that was important to Powell, in addition to the rehabilitation of his own role in the Iraq War.
That's not insignificant.
I think this was also, I think this is probably more driven by that, his estrangement, if outright hostility towards the Bush administration and their handling of the war and the judgments that were used leading up to it, including Powell's, including his own.
Right, right. Let me ask you this. Did Senator McCain call you, or were you on his short list, a long short list?
On a list. I don't know how short it was, but I was on a list. I've known Senator McCain a long time. He was very, very helpful to me when I ran for the U.S. Senate, as was Rudy Giuliani and Mitt Romney. So I was a brother locked in, landlocked. I said, no, I'm not endorsing anybody in the primary. But when we got to the general, Senator McCain and I, really got a chance to sort of work together, and I've tried to be very helpful to his campaign, worked with him to bring about and take him to the NAACP convention, the Urban League conventions. And so, I mean, he knows me, he knows my style. I'm a little bit of a maverick, too. I'm not, while I would be arguably a conservative, I consider myself more of a progressive conservative, more Lincoln-esque than anything else. And I think he appreciates that.
Right.
And so we talked about a lot of things, and here I sit, so you can tell how that conversation went.
You just mentioned, and you describe yourself in your bio as a Lincoln Republican.
That's right.
And what do you mean by that exactly?
I hearken back to the roots of this party. My mama taught me, my mama's from South Carolina, so it's good common sense, right?
Right.
And she taught me, as I said before, to be my own man, but most especially to think for myself. And if you want to know something, learn it. Go out and figure it out. Don't just let people tell you what you need to know or what you know, but go out and learn it and absorb it yourself, so that when people tell you something, you can see whether or not they're lying to you. Right?
Right, right.
And that's what I did
right.
when I matured enough to understand and appreciate the dynamics of politics. I went out and I learned about both parties. I learned about their histories. I learned about their role in my life to that date, and concluded that the political home of African Americans is the GOP.
Right.
Where we, you know, politically landed and stayed for a long time. Folks forget, we voted 90-10 Republican just as we That's voted 90-10 Democrat today.
Right.
And there were the changing sands of time, you know, such as they were, civil rights era especially, that where this separation began, where in fact I believe the party moved away from the black community as opposed to fully embracing not just the rhetoric of civil rights and the vote that we cast in the Senate to push out the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act, but to be stalwarts of that as we were at the founding of the party.
Right.
This party was founded by abolitionists, men and women dedicated to the abolition of slavery, freeing the black man, empowering the black man and woman to realize the American dream. 40 Acres and a Mule is the first affirmative action program put in place by the Republican Party for freed slaves. Richard Nixon and his administration under the leadership of some very, very strong African Americans put in place what we know today as the modern affirmative action program. It was that Lincoln-esque quality, though, that founding quality that focused on the individuals, the right of individuals to be free in this country, to realize and live the tenets of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, that I think our party needs to get back to. Our view of government, not that, you know, Lincoln Republicans aren't anti-government. Mm-hmm. What we want is government's proper place to be recognized and for government to recognize its proper place because this is a government of, by, and for whom? People, mm-hmm. not government. Mm-hmm. And so that, to me, is a very important principle when it comes to defining my politics, my view on the economy, the creation of what I like to call legacy wealth. The Rockefellers did it. The Vanderbilts did it. Oprah's doing it. Bob Johnson is doing mm-hmm. it. But not the entire black community is doing it. And that is being able to not only to consume wealth, but to create it, invest it, and save it. And that's why the view on taxes is so important.
Right.
If I earn it, okay, I have no problem giving to the general welfare through some tax form, but confiscatory tax policy is an aberration for me, because government didn't earn it.
Right.
The government didn't have to get up in the morning and pay the light bill to run that business, mm-hmm. or to go out and pay what it takes to hire that individual and to keep that individual working in your shop, to train them and et cetera. So, and now we're talking about, you know, I heard Senator Obama talking, you know, about his economic plan where the government is going to create, and the Bush administration too, I slapped them upside the head as well, creating jobs. The government doesn't create work. Sorry, government has never mm-hmm. in the history of mankind created a job, and it will not at this time or in the future, because what is required to create that job, government can't do. Government won't do. It can't afford to do. That's the risk that you and I take as entrepreneurs every day mm-hmm. when we go out there and sling whatever we sling to do what we do. Mm-hmm. Government's not going to do that. Government's not going to get down in the nitty-gritty of creating wealth.
What about in the post-Depression era with the Roosevelt plans, Tennessee Valley Authority, all of those work projects?
They're work projects, but someone had to do the work. Someone had to manage that and keep that going. And so it's a government enterprise, mm-hmm. but that's different working for the government.
Right.
That's different. Okay? Right. In Maryland, there are 82,000 people that work for government. All right? But 70% of our workforce, of our overall workforce, is private enterprise. Mm-hmm. Yes. And that government cannot do.
Right. Let me ask you this. So you make a persuasive argument here. So if I had a magic wand, I could wave it and put you in front of all African Americans an hour from now. Could you convince many of them to...
I could only convince them if they're willing to listen.
Okay.
And I found that that has not always been the case in our community.
Why is that?
I willingly go into hostile environments.
Okay.
And people think I'm nuts. But my argument is very simple. If I'm ever going to convince you, not that I'm right, God forbid, that's hubris beyond reason, mm-hmm. okay? But that I have something different to say, I have a different idea, maybe I have a different way to solve this problem for us, would you listen to it? That's how I go at it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have been equally persuaded by those who are less conservative or progressive, whatever the terms are, who have a different perspective than I am on a number of issues. Mm-hmm. And I've taken that and I've embraced it and kind of shaped it into my own. And I don't know, and I think part of it, when it comes to the Republican label, because it was an interesting thing that was just done, and I think I'll answer your question this way. Howard Stern just last week, I don't know if you saw this, and if you want to, it's on YouTube, it's on the internet, went out and interviewed people in Harlem. Hmm. And he asked them, who did they support for president? And they said, Barack Obama, Barack Obama, Barack Obama, Barack Obama. And they said, oh, really? I said, what is it that you like about Barack's policy? Is it his pro-life stance or his initiative to stay in Iraq until the job is finished? And some people said his pro-life stance. Some people said it was his initiatives mm-hmm. to stay in Iraq. And a lot of people said both. The next question was, well, what do you think about his running mate? Do you think Sarah Palin will make a great vice president? Absolutely. So you think Obama Palin ticket is a good ticket? Absolutely. I support it.
Right, right, right. You know, as a political scientist, this is a common phenomenon that voters in general now.
I thought that was hysterical.
Yes, yes.
But I thought it was sad, too. And I'll tell you what I thought was sad about it. It wasn't sad that people were either misinformed, miseducated, or whatever. Right. That wasn't what was sad to me. What saddened me was the fact that I juxtaposed that with other studies that go back to 1992 when George Bush the first ran against Bill Clinton.
Right.
And you would take George Bush's policies, what he wanted to do as president, and you'd ask people what they thought. 70%, 60% on any issue supported the policy. You take the exact same policy and you put the Republican candidate for president, 20%, 30%, 40% support. And it speaks to where the GOP has allowed itself to come to, and that we've become so consumed with national politics, winning the White House. Mm-hmm. We've become so consumed with a social agenda, all right, making sure everybody lives right, mm-hmm. that we forgot that people are living, and that people are living their lives with a lot of problems, a lot of issues, a lot of concerns, and they don't want a political party to sit in judgment of their lives. They don't want a political party to determine outcomes for them. What they want is political leadership that will clear the pathways necessary for them to address those issues in their lives, and that maybe will make tomorrow a little less stressful than today, that maybe will make tomorrow a little bit easier to get through. And we've lost sight of that. Right. And that's what I took away from the Howard Stern study.
Right.
Because I thought it was very telling in many ways of our failure to really engage the imagination of people and to have them trust the judgment and the leadership of the GOP at a time of war, of economic failure and crisis, when they need that kind of leadership.
How does the party get back to the place where you would like to bring it? What kind of leadership is necessary?
Start drinking now. Drown your sorrows. You know, that's a good question. That's a question, Professor, that I'm sort of toying with right now. It's very timely. I title it What Next? The What Next. Whether McCain wins or not, in many respects, is irrelevant. Mm-hmm. The What Next question will stand stark for the GOP. Because I go back to in 2004, and at the end of the National Convention, I remember standing on the floor of the hall, Madison Square Garden, among a sea of balloons and confetti. Everybody's out, and it's, you know, they're breaking down the set, and I'm standing there with some buddies, and I'm looking around the room, and I go, we have just entered a crisis. And they were like, what? It was a great celebration. I'm like, no, the party's going to have to confront itself. Because as I looked down the road to 2008, I saw Rudy Giuliani standing there. I saw, at that time, a George Pataki, Governor Pataki, standing there. Mm-hmm. I saw a lot of Republican leaders who didn't necessarily fit the Ronald Reagan mold that we have crafted, you know, forgetting that Ronald Reagan was himself at one time pro-life, right. Pro-choice, a union guy.
A Democrat.
Right. You know, all these things. We kind of, you know, lionized the guy mm-hmm. to make him something other than what he really was. that we've set up this litmus test of what it meant and what it is to be Republican, losing sight of the core Lincoln-esque principles mm-hmm. of who we are and what defines us. You may be pro-choice, I may be pro-life, but there's something about being Republican that links us that has nothing to do with your pro-choice views or my pro-life views. That's where the party has, that's what the party's lost sight of. And so we've begun to isolate and ostracize people within our own party.
Right.
And I think that that's gonna be the initial test for the what, in answering the what next question, is how do we begin to recognize that, wait a minute, you Republican and I'm Republican, what makes us Republican? Mm-hmm. What do you define as Republican? What do I define as Republican? And then carve out that commonality and go from there. Because you'll trip up every day over other issues that really divide. The party is, and I think will be, fundamentally a party that supports life, that's for life. But it is not dispositive in everything we do. It is not, you know, definitional in everything about us. And I think that that's sort of the next hurdle for us to overcome. Otherwise, you become marginalized. And as some were proclaiming at the end of the 04 election, of a great political realignment in favor of the GOP, we may see a great political realignment, a permanent one, in favor of Democrats and especially the left.
Right. Now, in your present work, you're chairman of GOPAC,
yep. which is
Republican Political Action Committee,
mm-hmm.
and you're responsible for recruiting and training.
Training candidates, state and local candidates, yeah.
Yeah. Now, is that difficult in this environment to do?
You know, it's kind of hard to find a brother that's willing to run.
Right.
You know, when people are throwing stuff at them, right. you know, and the brand isn't a good brand. Yeah, I think that there's a lot of frustration there. But we have around the country, a number of candidates that are running in some very competitive races. One in Florida, in Georgia, the 3rd District of Georgia, Dr. Deborah Honeycutt, African-American mm-hmm. Republican, running a fairly aggressive competitive campaign in her district. We see the potential of electing the first black Republican legislator in California in 75 years.
Hmm.
So there are pockets there. We have a number of candidates in other jurisdictions where we could win and tip the balance such that the GOP could take control of the state legislature, the House or the Senate, in some cases both, or win a governorship. So even in this is what I've been saying to a lot of Republicans around the country, even in the midst of what is perhaps the ugliest period for us ever in history, I mean, it wasn't this bad when the party was forming and the abolitionists was going up against, you know, the slaveholders
right.
in terms of branding.
Right.
But the glass is half full, because at the grassroots level, what I'm finding and what I tried to do at GOPAC is identifying men and women to run from the districts they live in. I can't run effectively a conservative who lives in a moderate to liberal district. Guess what? You get through the primary, but you're going to lose the general.
Mm-hmm.
I can't run the reverse in a conservative district with a moderate or liberal Republican. But what I can do is that I can run a Republican who grows up out of the community in which he lives, who's going to reflect back to that community the values of that community. So if they're moderate, that candidate's likely going to be more moderate than conservative and will likely appeal to those voters and win that general election. So then guess what? Now I've just sent another Republican to the state legislature or to the city council or made a mayor. And that's where you gain that momentum and you begin to reassert that confidence that the voters have in you, because they're trusting your leadership by right. electing you.
Right. Let me ask you this question. So in part of this work, you're training leaders.
Yep.
How do you train leaders?
Well, the first thing I do is I train them the way my mother trained me as a young boy, to shut up and listen.
Hmm.
Politicians have this phenomenal ability to go into a room and start talking and have no idea what anyone in the room is saying because they're talking.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing you got to do is shut up and listen. You've got to pay attention to the environment you're in. Our problem right now is that we fail to pay attention to the environment we are in. We fail to pay attention to the warning signs that were brewing. Remember, the GOP nationally executed a contract in 1994, the contract with America, in which we said we'd be good fiscal stewards, that we would mind the store, that we would not grow government but keep it in proper check, that we would do the things that would be required of our leadership that you entrusted us. And what did we do? We stopped paying attention. We stopped listening. And we got consumed by being in Washington and running everything. And we became like the very people we were sent to replace. And guess what? In 06, we got replaced. And more of us will be replaced in 08.
Right.
So you need to begin to understand the landscape, the surroundings, the environment you're in by listening to people and appreciating them. Now, that's something that Barack did. Hillary even didn't do that. That's how she wound up losing the primary, because she wasn't tuned in to what people were saying. And in addition to the political missteps of not running in the caucuses, you know, you really kind of stump your own game. Barack listens. Now, I may disagree with the prescription that he's offering, but he's at least listening, and he's offering something that people are going, okay, and if they don't hear anything else, if they don't hear any alternative, then they're going to go with that.
Right.
And that's where we are right now. There's not been a credible alternative positioned against Barack in the primary or in this general, particularly with respect to this financial crisis. The GOP has the prescription. We have the argument. Free up capital. Free enterprise. Let people, not unbridled enterprise. Again, we didn't listen.
Right.
We deregulated. Deregulation, folks, doesn't mean you stop oversight.
Right.
You stop listening. You stop paying attention to what they're doing. All right? Deregulation says we're going to free up the marketplace for you to go and do what you do best. But that doesn't mean we're going to stop watching. We're going to be a watchdog and make sure you're not hurting people. You're not, you know, consuming too much. You're not, you know, overextending yourself in the market. So all of these things come into place, and I try to crystallize that for candidates to appreciate. Look at the environment around you. Learn from the history, not 1860 history, you know, 2006 history, and appreciate the land you're standing on right now and how you're going to move forward. Now, how, just as you asked me, how would I go into that room of 100 or plus African Americans and get them to, you know, agree with me? Well, I'm not trying to get you to agree with me. I just need you to listen to me.
Right.
And the way that begins, the way that happens, is if I begin by listening to you.
Right. Now, one thing, I mean, on a college campus like this and others across the country, you find that students, you know, the 18 to 25 year olds are quite cynical and ambivalent about politics at best. How would you approach that with college kids? I mean, why should they care and why should they be interested?
Well, I think well, again, going back to Barack, he has awakened that political enterprising spirit within young people. We can talk about the dangers of that, and there are good examples of that already. Of what happens if you don't complete the task, if you don't close that circle. With young folks, my estimation, working with a lot of college campuses, on a lot of college campuses, GOP and speaking and so forth, is that cynical approach comes from a number of places, emanating first from, I don't want to really be bothered.
Right, right.
I got way more important things I'm doing than to go to some political rally or to sit and listen to some guy drone on for 2 hours about nothing I'm interested in.
Right. Well, you look at the $770 billion bailout, they ought to be concerned about that.
Well, right? That's where you get. They need to be, because that tab is yours.
Right, right.
You're paying that tab.
Right.
You and I will maybe pay a small portion of it.
Right.
But the bulk of it is going to be longer term. What I tell young people is you have a stake in this. First off, don't believe the hype that you don't have anything vested in this. Don't believe the hype that because you're 18 that you don't have a role to play. I even tell 12-year-olds. I tell fifth graders. Don't believe the hype that you don't have something at stake. Yeah, you may not be able to vote in fifth grade, but you have a voice. You have an opinion. You think and feel certain things, whether you hear it in your household, you hear it on the playground. Same is true here on college campuses. You have an opinion about these things. You come to these issues with a set of interests, some heightened, some not so heightened. What I try to do is try to get you to recognize that all of it's connected to something that's going to affect you when you leave this institution. This is la-la land. It's the best 4 years of your life. It will not get any better than this. Trust me. Okay? Trust me. because the day you leave this institution, you pay bills, you take on obligations, you have third parties who will be impacting you in ways you can't even begin to imagine now, where you have absolutely no voice or no say.
Right.
So this is your time to begin to figure out that voice, to begin to figure out what it is you do want to say, and to assert yourself so when you confront those realities that hit you, you have standing, legal jargon. You have standing. You have a right to be there, and you have a right to express yourself. And I think that that's significantly important because a lot of our college kids today, like their parents, are trying to figure out, how am I going to pay to go to Duke? How am I going to, make my ends meet while I'm at Duke? So there are a lot of questions that they're beginning to have to address right now that's tied to a political figure who will sit in a chamber, whether in Washington, D.C., or here in North Carolina, and cast a vote that's going to impact that decision that you have to make. And that's where you have a real responsibility and a role to play.
Right. Now, I think I read in your bio that you first went to Catholic seminary.
Yeah.
For 2 or 3 years.
I was a monastery, yeah. Can't you tell?
And
I was a monk. It's the hair thing. You know? It's got the hairline thing working there. That's what it is.
And then you went to law school. You left
the seminary. Some people say I went from being a saint to a sinner, yeah.
Yeah, that is somewhat of a big transition.
Actually, can I tell you, there's no difference. A life of poverty, chastity, and obedience is no different than what I'm doing right now. So
what led you to that transition from the seminary to law school?
Well, for me, it ultimately boiled down to a calling, a sense of service. I wanted to be a priest ever since I was a kid, mm-hmm. third grade. I was an altar boy and master of ceremonies in my church. And I was involved at a time where the church was still, it was transitioning. My generation is really a transitional generation. We were transitioning from the Latin Mass to the vernacular. And so all these changes going on, you were coming out of the idyllic world of the 50s into the turbulent 60s. And then, the God help us 1970s and, all of that. So we've always kind of been, I've always been a part of that generation that's kind of in transition. For me, to deal with that transition was a call to service. Mm-hmm. How do I affect people's lives? At the time, up until, I left the seminary, for me it was living a life of service as a priest. As a monastic priest, and hopefully doing what God is calling me to do in an honorable mm-hmm. and just way. But then that process, a big part of that process is journey. It is discovery and recognizing your limitations and your expectations, and trying to listen to God's call. Again, listening, shutting up long enough to hear what God is asking you to do. Mm-hmm. And then gathering the stomach and the will to do it, because sometimes the simplest thing is the hardest thing. And that's a real challenge for people. And it's something that we don't often recognize about ourselves as humans, how we limit ourselves and how we are limited by some of the simplest things.
Right.
And so that service, sense of service translated for me of, coming out and saying, how can I best served? Do I serve God in a religious habit, or do I serve Him in a business suit? It led me to the law. I love that line in The Advocate, where the devil is talking to his son, Keanu Reeves and Al Pacino, and he's talking to, not Al Pacino, I forget, well, anyway, I don't want to get bogged down that, but he's saying to him, he asked him, well, why did you, the devil, why did you choose a law? He said, what's the new priesthood? I thought it was such a great line. But it's true, too. I mean, I think, how you find the tools to serve honorably and well. And for me, it was through law and politics. And the best days for me, the happiest time was when I was lieutenant governor, serving people every day, making government actually work instead of getting in folks' way. Mm-hmm. To me, it was very, very rewarding. Not personally for so much, but just seeing it in the faces of so many people who, figure that, yeah, I can trust this institution to do right by me.
Mm-hmm. As a political scientist and one who studies and watches politicians, I mean, it just struck me in this exchange, when I speak with or read about or talk to African-American politicians, regardless of Democrats, mm-hmm. Republicans, the church and religion comes up as something that's been very important in the development of a leadership style mm-hmm. or a call to service and leadership. Mm-hmm. And you rarely hear white politicians talk about it in the same way.
Yeah, isn't it? That's interesting. I think a lot of that goes back to our origins in this country. The church has always been the center of our lives. In slavery, it was the one time we could all gather in one place and not cause concern.
Right, right.
And from that structure, that emanated our political and our legal and our economic and all the other little avenues that would shape and fashion Black life in this country. So the church then and now, as we've seen played out in this presidential election, is a central part of defining the Black experience, mm-hmm. defining Black men and women, and defining especially Black political leadership. Dr. King to Reverend Jackson, Reverend Sharpton, as figures, but even individuals. Myself, Barack, Harold Ford, so many others who are, sort of carrying out the time-honored tradition, if you will, of the Black church as being a central portion, part of our experience and what we do. The church is now playing a significant role in redefining how the Black community emerges in a post-civil rights era. I've always looked at this era, this time, as being one in which we move from sitting at the lunch counter to owning the diner. And the church is going to play a big role in helping us do that. As you see, many churches, many congregations mm-hmm. are now branched. They're not not running to government and saying, oh, gee, Mr. Government, can I have a check so I can build a rec center? What are they doing? They're going into the market. They're going into banks. They're going into private sector, gathering the wealth from outside and from within to build these institutions themselves. They're taking ownership. They're owning the diner. And I think that's so important. And because from that, you will see transition leadership that will appreciate, I think, again, the proper role of government. This goes back to my Lincoln-esque view of it, the proper role of government in the lives of people, but most especially how empowering and freeing it is when you own, which is something we need to learn how to do. We consume like crazy.
Right. Right.
We don't own like right. crazy.
Now, square that, though, that position with the Bush administration's initiative, the faith-based initiatives, in which they did come to churches. Here's the check if you do these things.
Well, no, they didn't. That's a misunderstanding of that, because I was involved. I've been involved with that initiative going back to 1999. And what then-Governor Bush did in Texas, what he tried to do at the federal level, and the missteps that were a part of that. But the misperception was, here's a check from the government. No, that's not what it was at all. In fact, I created, as lieutenant governor, a faith-based initiative for Maryland, even though the state legislature wouldn't let me call it a faith-based initiative, so I called it a community initiative. I'm a lawyer, I just changed the name, right? Same thing, just changed the name. Everybody was like, oh, okay. But the reality of it was finding those resources that are out there and pooling those resources so that the church would have access to them. Look, the church at the end of the day can take a dollar and get $1.25, $1.50 worth of value out of that dollar. Mm-hmm. Whereas the government will take a dollar and spend $2 to figure out how to get a dollar value out of it. Mm-hmm. All right? That's the reality. That's why I go back to my initial point. Government don't do jobs. Mm-hmm. All right? It doesn't create wealth. It creates bureaucracy. And so in the faith-based initiative, the Bush administration's initial view of this was to free up the markets, if you will, to give greater access to churches and faith-based institutions so they could do the good work that they do without relying on government, without, as I said before, going to government and saying, hey, can I fit into this program and get a check? Whereas we want to be able to put you in the marketplace so that you can use that in addition to other streams of income to enhance what you do. And what we're seeing Black churches especially do right now, how do you think they're building these mega churches?
Right.
That's not government money.
Right.
Now, the government may give a tax break here or there, or they may give a TIF over in that area so that you can do what you need to do. But at the end of the day, it's the private sector opening itself, or more importantly, being open to these churches in a way that allows those churches to maximize that relationship to the benefit of the community they're serving. And so I think that the faith-based initiative, and Barack himself has spoken to the faith-based initiative as an honorable and something that he, I presume, would try to do or instill in his administration. So it is not this idea of giving money from the government to these institutions. There's a constitutional provision against that, I believe, where the separation of churches. So you don't want the government saying, all right, here's some money, because to a church.
Well, for secular purpose, right, you could have a soup kitchen.
Yeah, but that's my point. Without all the bells and whistles and the required legal parameters, right, you then cross that line.
Right.
And so what you're saying, the permissible use of that money, as long as you're within those parameters, that's fine.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think that's something that is important, not just for federal government, but for state and local governments to be engaged in as well. How else do these institutions care for the sick, the poor, deal with drug addicted individuals, deal with the homeless, deal with spousal abusers, et cetera?
Right, right. Let me ask you this question. I mean, you look around the Republican Party, and there seems to be quite a nice supply of talented African Americans, yourself included.
Thank you.
Congolese Rice.
Yep.
Former member of Congress, J.C. Watt. Kenneth Blackwell,
mm-hmm.
And many others. When you look at Senator McCain's campaign, you don't see a visible presence of this talent. In fact, I think even J.C. Watt complained about this last summer.
He did. That's, again, one of those double standards that black Republicans especially have to live with, and the party has to live with, that, for example, you don't see black folks around. Well, they're there. They're in the background. They're doing what they do in any other campaign setting. They're not as visible necessarily. I mean, Condoleezza and Colin Powell, certainly visible figures, along with Alphonso Jackson and so many others, who didn't just have, here's a role, go sit at a desk.
Right.
I mean, these were leaders of departments and sub-cabinet departments. And the Bush administration has done more in that regard than any president, period.
Oh, no, come on.
Than any president.
Bill Clinton?
Absolutely. Go back and look at Bill Clinton's record. Look now. Don't look at the number of appointments. Seriously, don't look at the number of appointments. Look at where they were appointed. Because anyone can do a desk job. Line item management. In other words, you got a line item in the federal budget that you're running. It's a whole different ball game. Not the assistant secretary to the assistant secretary job. I'm talking about deputy secretaries. I'm talking about the number two and the number three.
How about the number one?
And the number ones. There are a lot of now cabinet level is secretary of state, secretary, national security advisor, secretary of housing, and some others.
Right.
But below that, the people who actually run the government. All right, not the folks who you see on 6 o'clock news.
Right,
the
right.
People actually run the government. Significant effort. And again, that's one of the. And I smack this administration because they do not tout the success and the good stories and the good things they've done. What they've done on Africa, what they've done for HBCUs in this country, the funding for HBCUs in this country, through the roof. Phenomenal amount of federal dollars now available. All right, but you don't know that. They don't tell that story. Why? I have no idea. But I'd be seeing it from the rooftop, particularly if you know black folks don't like you,
Right.
Again, there are a lot of misperceptions and misunderstandings and misstatement of fact that exist about what Republicans generally, what this administration has done on behalf of the black community. No Child Left Behind, while it has flaws, has done a phenomenal job of raising the skill level of African Americans in poorly run public schools.
Right.
I can attest to that in my own city, of my own state of Maryland, in the city of Baltimore.
Right.
When you look at the performance of black students at K through third grade. All right. Now, the problem, again, goes to the fact that when you put in place these programs and these policies, government has a tendency to do it and then walk away from it. You got to stay on top of it. It's just like, free up the market, but then don't manage it. Don't monitor it. The same thing here. No child left behind. You should step back and listen to the teachers and say, okay, what's working, what isn't working? Tweak it to get it right. But when you start, the history of this administration has been when people start complaining, they back away from it. They don't want to talk about it anymore. They just kind of, all right, we won't do that anymore.
Right.
Well, no, you've got a good program here. We just need you to get it to work even better than it's working.
Right.
So, you know, I think that there are stories that haven't been told, probably will not be told now the administration's going out.
But why is that? I mean, that's quite.
But they're there.
That's quite bizarre.
It is bizarre.
Especially for politicians, yeah. Like they want to claim credit.
Now, you know,
I can give an answer. What I think it is. I mean, where if what you say is correct, that you know below the surface and below the radar screen, mm-hmm. that the Bush administration has done all these things for the African American community, and yet no one's talking about it.
Housing, a good example. Housing in up until this recent crash in the housing market. For the first time ever, more minorities, especially African Americans, own their own homes than ever before in history. We reached plus 50%. Mm-hmm. That was because of the housing policies that were put in place to sort of not getting into the Freddie and Fannie craziness about you know subprime mortgages, but legitimate mortgage programs, legitimate housing programs for those who were moving out of rental property into home ownership. Who moved from a low paying job to a better paying job, taking advantage of those who may not have had who rehabilitated their credit, but because credit markets are the way they were, they still didn't get, you know. So there were a lot of things that were put in place to help, but didn't talk about it.
Right. You know, it sounds like you know to take a line from the current presidential campaign, spread into wealth. Is what you seem to be describing.
Slightly different. Slightly, because we're not taking from Peter to pay Paul. We're creating something out of whole cloth for everyone to take advantage of. That's a whole different ball game than my going into your pocket and taking out of your pocket to put in my pocket.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because then I know the government's going to do what next? It's coming to my pocket.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, that's that little thing we don't need to get into.
Right.
You know, that whole, you know, spreading the wealth. Now, I'm not spreading. If I earn it, I want to keep it.
Right.
I don't want to give it to nobody else who didn't earn it.
Right.
Now, if I want to give it to somebody else who earned it, guess what? They work for me.
Right.
That's how this works.
Yeah. But, you know, you look at this country, demographic trends. It's not something in the future, it's something in the present. California and Texas are no longer majority white states.
Mm-hmm.
And the Census Bureau projections will be about 2050.
You know, like I'd say even sooner than that. I'd say 5 years from now, this country is going to be majority minority.
Right. And so if the Republican Party can do all these things but not be willing to claim credit and to go out to these communities and actively recruit to the party mm-hmm. These individuals. What does that mean?
They die.
Is that going to happen?
Yeah, they die. No, it won't happen because not if I have anything to do about it.
Right.
It won't happen.
Right. Who's with you then? I mean,
Else? There are a number. You mentioned half of them. JC and Lynn Swan and Ken Blackwell and Deborah Honeycutt mm-hmm. and a whole host of elected, non-elected candidates, activists who are out there. There are a number of us who, you know, are already looking and beginning to answer for the party and for ourselves that what next question that we began this conversation with. And I think it's vitally important that we begin to put that answer in place because otherwise we'll become politically irrelevant.
Right. And you think you
I mean, would you join a party where there was no party?
It's hard to do.
I mean, if I'm going to go to a party, I want a party, right? I want to have something there. I want something to draw me in that keeps me there.
Right. You know? So you understand the perception, right?
Sure, absolutely.
Among the mass public.
Absolutely.
So would you guys have a seat at the table, the Republican Party? I mean, in this what next phase?
Which is what I appreciated so much about, to answer the question, yes, people will have a seat at the Republican table if they want it, number one. Number two, what I appreciate about what John McCain did at the NAACP convention, he stood on that stage, he gave a very compelling speech, and then, you know, during which he said, he looked at the audience, he said, now I know that no one in this room is voting for me. All right, I know that. But when I'm your president, you will have a seat at my table in the White House. No one has said that. Not even Barack has said that.
Mm-hmm.
Made that very definitive declarative statement to the black community that they will have a seat at the table in the White House. And I thought that was significant. I thought it was very important for us to hear and for him to say. And now, if he gets elected, he's got to follow up, and it'll be guys like me in the room making sure he does.
Right.
Number, but if he doesn't get elected, it then becomes important for guys like me and others to pick up where he left off, to create that seat at the table in our party for those who are willing to consider 360 the issues of the day. I'm not in the business of convincing you to be a Republican. I'm not in the business to get, I mean, I even have an issue about registering as a Republican. You want to register a Republican, that's fine. That doesn't tell me how you're going to vote.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
It doesn't tell me how you're going to vote.
That's right.
And it doesn't tell me what you think really about issues. What I want to try to do is to get you to embrace the idea of Republicanism and apply that to the various issues of your life. And then show you and run across in front of you a myriad of candidates who represent a cross-section, the Big Tent, that was that so many of our party ascribed to and believed in for so long until it kind of started taking down the poles
right.
and the tent collapsed.
Right.
To show you this broad spectrum of what it is to be a Republican. It's going to be a challenge. There's no doubt about it. There's going to be a lot of recriminations if McCain loses, and a lot of wringing of the hands and gnashing of teeth. I don't have time for that.
Right.
God only gave me a limited amount of time on this planet, and I don't know when the clock is going to check out. So between now and that moment, let's go. Let's get something done. Let's move. We know we've got the right package. Now let's just dust it off, clean it up, and go back to the people and try again.
Yeah. Let's talk about the people, because we've been talking about at the elite level. If you look at, say, the Republican Party at on the ground, the mass level, I grew up here in North Carolina, and you have Jesse Helm Republicans. Now, can they coexist in the party that you
I don't know.
Envision?
We'll see.
If you go out, if you travel in this state and across South, the Midwest.
I've been in North Carolina so much this year, I've actually begun to take up residence here.
Don't vote.
Don't vote.
You get in trouble.
No, I'm not voting here.
You get in trouble.
I'll get in trouble. That's a very good question, and therein lies the rub. That's the test. I don't know. It depends on how much the party really wants to fight to get back into the hearts and minds of the American people. I think that there will be issues in an Obama administration that will lend itself to that debate and that discussion. I think that there will be issues in a McCain administration, quite frankly, that will lend itself to that debate and discussion. The point is, that debate and discussion is going to have to take place. And the party's going to have to come to grips, as I realized in 2004 on the floor of Madison Square Garden, that this is not your mama's and your daddy's Republican Party
right.
anymore.
Right.
It's a very different animal. And a lot of different pieces are coming into play. And you will either embrace those pieces and make them a part of the total mosaic of the GOP, or you're not. And if you don't, when you look at it, you're going to see gaping holes and cracks and crevices. That will not withstand time nor its own weight, and it will collapse.
Right, right. I mean, this is not unlike what the Democrats face for years.
And still face. I think the Democrats are living a lie right now.
Why do you say that?
Because what they've done very effectively is that they have co-opted the Karl-Rovian strategies. And I know this for fact, because I've talked with a lot of the thinking minds behind it. The Rahm Emanuels of the party have been very effective of creating this new hybrid, the Blue Dog Democrat, pro-life, pro-Second Amendment, fiscal conservatives, Democrats.
Mm-hmm.
Where do they fit in the Democratic Party? Very much like on the GOP side, you know, the pro-choice, moderate, social Republican. Where do they fit in on the GOP side? So in an effort to win, everyone's kind of taking that and say, okay, we ain't going to deal with that. We don't deal with that right now. Let's win.
Right.
When you win, what you going to do? What happens in the House of Representatives on the floor with Nancy Pelosi running things when a Heath Shuler has an issue as a Blue Dog Democrat that he wants a vote on that needs to get addressed, or she has an issue, the Speaker does, that is an anathema to him and the people he represents, that tension has got to be dealt with. Now, it's a healthy tension in politics.
Mm-hmm.
It's a natural part of it. But let's not fool ourselves into thinking that, you know, this is all kumbaya and la-la land on the Democratic side, because they themselves have created within their body politic an outlet for those Reagan-type Democrats, if you will, what we called Reagan Democrats and we now call Blue Dog Democrats, who are conservative Democrats. If and as their numbers grow, what do you do?
Right.
What happens to the left of the party? Where do they go? What happens to that? What happens to that social view that says government is not bad, that tax policy, as we heard Barney Frank say just a few days ago, I think, you know, deficits, don't worry about deficits. I think we need to spend more money. And, yeah, I think we need to tax more people to pay for the money we're spending. Does Heath Shuler believe that? Do those Blue Dogs take that point of view on fiscal and economic policy? Therein lies the tension, and it'll be interesting to see how it plays out.
Yeah, you raise some issues, and it seems to me this is the question for leadership.
Absolutely.
And it seems to me that happy Democrats managed to put in place leaders who can manage these tensions.
No.
And you think not?
No, they haven't managed it.
Obama doesn't.
No, he hasn't been in the Senate long enough to know how the tension works.
Let's go back beyond, even before that. I mean, you mentioned it was Robian. I mean, I would say it's Clintonian. And that Roe stole it from Clinton. And Bill Clinton, it seemed to me, was the one who put this together.
No, what Clinton did. I think that's fair. Clinton created the Democratic Leadership Conference. And it was outside the party.
Right.
Outside the liberal wing of the party, right. Which is why the left went after Hillary. This was payback. This is beautiful. This is so Shakespearean. I love it. And you know the Clintons created this political entity outside of the traditional structure, and lo and behold, they won with it. They weren't supposed to do that. Remember, '92, nobody would run against George Bush. He was 92% job approval, And so Clinton was like, "Call me stupid, I'll do it." And then 6 months later, he turned around and said, "No, hey, Mr. President, it's the economy, stupid."
Right.
And he won. Mm-hmm. Okay. So he created this thing. Bubba then goes back home. GOP, big problem, because our Southern strategy now all blowed up. Bubba won the presidency. They have some place to go back to. They went back to the Democratic Party. Those Reagan Democrats went back to the Democratic Party. The GOP is now standing there with no national strategy, you know, going, duh, now what? So all those coalitions that they ignored building over the years, they now need it, or now Democrats.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Hispanics, blacks, Catholics, Jews, you name them, women, they're all Democrats. Because we didn't bother, because look, with our strategy, we had the white male, we got the South, we'll win.
And that may be in question now. I mean,
it's done, it's over.
Look at Virginia and this state,
it's done.
Some of the current polling
absolutely,
numbers.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's a flawed strategy. Just because it worked for 30 or 40 years doesn't mean it isn't flawed. Because invariably, it catches up with you.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't have something that sustains you in transition, that gets you through the ebbs and flows of demographic changes and political changes, you find yourselves where we are. So I take your point. It's Clintonian. Rove improved on it and adapted to the post Southern strategy, if
right,
you will.
Right.
But as you see, it's based on one person. It's ideologically based. We draw red state, blue state. We get into this tension that's not designed to bring us together, but actually to create greater distance. And as we've now found 6 years into that, you don't win. You can't win. Because again, people, going back to your point about leadership, they're looking for men and women who are as tired as they are of playing games.
Right.
And they want someone who's going to do something. All right, I'm going to send you to Washington. You better do something. And I tell every candidate that I train, don't screw it up. Because if you screw it up, not only are your voters coming after you, I'm coming after you. And I think it's important for them to understand, to put that in context, that this means stuff. You know, you're jumping out there as a leader has consequences. People are going to expect you to do something. You better do it.
Yeah. Might we see a third party?
That's exciting. That's an exciting proposition. Mm-hmm. My answer to that is yeah. I think you will. I think in this post Southern strategy, Clinton, Rovian era, as we enter the age of Obama,
right.
even if he doesn't win, the politics has been transformed. And I think now a lot of people will realize, oh, heck, I can do this. Like, what do you mean? I could do this. Why don't you run? I'm going to write a check. Here's $10,000. Right. You know, and I think all of a sudden it does change. And I think that's healthy for America. You know, I think it's important for America. But I do note what our first president, George Washington, said in one of the last speeches that he gave, that the political parties would be the undoing of America. And I always keep that in the back of my mind, because he, like a lot of the founding fathers, who lost the argument about having a political system of parties, mm-hmm. Had a real concern about the impact and effect it would have on the people. And I think we've seen that. I think we've seen that starting in 2000. The hatred, the bitterness, people, you know, willing to tear up the Constitution over an election, and it's a real because of their political, party-driven, you know, angst. Mm-hmm. It's a real concern for this country to be mindful of, and to watch for down the road.
Right. One last question. We talked and we mentioned in the course of this conversation, several times, sort of this country's divided in some dangerous ways in many respects. What will the next president, whomever it is, have to do to bring the country back together?
Oh, good luck. I
mean, that's some serious problems.
It's a serious problem.
The war,
yeah.
And the economy and the tank.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. I don't know. I think it's very difficult right now to do. I think part of me says a lot of the polarization we've got to work out of our system. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. People have got to go, oh, well, okay, I'm done with that. Let's move on. And then when they get there to that point, there's got to be something there for them. I don't know what that is. Mm-hmm. You know, Obama's message is up here, but I live here, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. I'm down here. And I don't know if all that translates for me. And, you know, when you start talking about, you know, sharing the wealth, I hear something different than you hear. Mm-hmm. And that's where leadership is tested, because you got to get us to hear the same thing, mm-hmm. in order for us to come together.
Right.
Or you, at least if we don't hear the same thing, what I hear, I'm not threatened by. I can live with it, or I can go, oh, okay, whatever. So there's a lot of those dynamics that the next president is going to have to deal with. And as Joe Biden ruefully or otherwise said, you know, the next president is going to be tested. Mm-hmm. And in that testing, it's going to be even harder to bring people together.
Right. Yeah. I thought of something else. You know, I thought that was the last question.
Yeah, sure.
I thought of something else.
Sure.
And what if Senator Obama, if he were to win, were to invite Senator McCain to join his administration in some capacity?
Good question. I don't know if McCain would do it. But this is the same individual who very much wanted to pick Joe Lieberman,
right.
as his
right.
running mate, who John Kerry wanted as his running mate in 2004,
right.
despite what Mr. Kerry said the other day, shame on you. I think that's a very good question. I don't know what the answer to that
right.
would be.
Right.
I know that a President McCain would have Democrats in his administration, mm-hmm. Lieberman being the first to come to mind. There would be others. And I'm almost certain that an Obama presidency would have Republicans, Chuck Hagel
right.
being one, comes to mind. Maybe even a Colin Powell.
Dick Lugar.
Richard Lugar. But again, the test for me, see, if I'm in that shoe, and I know I'm a conservative, I bring in a liberal. I want to keep it honest.
Right.
I want to keep me honest and real in my leadership. So for me to get a moderate, okay, we're close enough that it's, you know,
right.
you know, it's good for government work.
Right.
You know, the test for leadership, and I've kind of come to this for myself, and this is the philosophy that I kind of govern myself under. It's easy to lead. you can lead all the time. You always have opportunities to lead. The test for leadership is when you have to follow, because that's when you demonstrate real leadership. Mm. Because everyone around you, when we're in a group setting, for example, and I am the leader, but you have an idea that is better than mine and actually will work, all right?
Right.
The leader dies to self and goes, good idea, you the man, I'm following your lead on this. And people learn from that. If the response is, well, I don't know, and I find ways to pick it apart and tear it down, or then sneak behind you and take the idea and make it my own anyway, that's not leadership. People watch that too, and they learn from it. Right. And so the real test for leadership is when you have to die to self, check your ego, and let someone else lead. And that moment for a president is when he's willing to bring into his administration people who do not necessarily have the same view. And I give you Abraham Lincoln, who did exactly that,
right,
who surrounded himself with people who were his political
enemy,
and in some cases, more than political enemy. His vice president was an avowed racist and slaveholder. So I think it makes you honest in your leadership when you're really prepared to go out on a limb. And I have not seen that in Barack. I say not in a partisan way, but as an honest 30,000-foot observer of this past year, when has he tested, when has his leadership tested itself, or he's tested it by going against his party? I mean, going against, I mean, you know, not this, you know, namsy-pamsy, you know, oh, let's pass a bill that you know everybody's going to agree to anyway, but really go up against the grain of the party and go against type and really push the envelope in doing something that people may get a little ticked off about. We'll see.
Right. Thanks so much for doing this.
All right. My pleasure.
Yes, exactly.
It's a real joy to be with you.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Let's hope it wasn't too bad.